In 2007, System Shock 2's writer-slash-designer Ken Levine would go on to make the game's spiritual successor, BioShock. The game was extraordinarily well-received and would go on to become a staple in the industry for years to come. Then, in 2013, he would go on to make BioShock Infinite, which was also very well-received and regarded by many as to be the best game in the series. Not by me. Personally, I played the game recently and hated it. Yeah, the game's not that great. But the point is that a lot of people did really enjoy it. But between those two entries, there was actually another. One that people don't really talk about for some reason. But why is that? Well, how about we find out for ourselves? Let's take a look at BioShock 2. You guys remember that Ken Levine guy I mentioned earlier? He was a really big part of System Shock 2, BioShock, and BioShock Infinite? Well, it turns out his dev team was also made up of a lot of System Shock 2 devs. That's a really good team to have working on your game. And also makes it very unfortunate that they weren't involved in BioShock 2 at all. Yeah, not off to a good start. But that doesn't necessarily mean that it's going to be bad. A repeat dev team does not guarantee for a good game. After all, Casey Hudson directed Mass Effect 2, and then wrote Mass Effect 3's ending. He even blocked the writing team from having any input on that at all. Good call on that one, you idiot. What was I talking about again? Wait a minute, does that mean... Yes, it does! We're playing as the resident badass this time around, the Big Daddy. That's fine by me. Jack's story from the first game was pretty much resolved, so no need to drag him back down to Rapture for this one. Now come on, let's get to drilling some... Shit.
Do you understand? Her name is Eleanor, and she is mine. Now, kneel, please. Remove your helmet. Place it against your head. Fire.
Well, that was short-lived. But no, it turns out we're okay. 10 years later, anyway. World's slowest Vita chamber, I guess. Well, off to do whatever it is a Big Daddy does when he doesn't have a little sister. Like cram electricity into our arm.
Daddy was sleeping for such a long time, and Eleanor has missed you. Find her and you'll be all better.
Huh. Later, then.
Ah, at last, a signal. You, who are bringing this dead city to life, listen. My name, it is Tannenbaum. I know who you are, and I am in much need of your help. Please, find me in the Atlantic Express train station.
Is it just me, or does Dr. Tannenbaum sound oddly Russian for somebody who's supposed to be German? Well, anyway, that aside, she tells us to meet her over at the train station. I guess it's something for us to do, but not before an introduction to the Big Sister. This is the first real fight of BioShock 2, and it pretty quickly teaches you the lesson that just because you're a Big Daddy, you are hardly a tank. In fact, you're kinda just better off forgetting all of those Big Daddy fights from the first game, because you're only just barely stronger than an ordinary splicer. Wait. Yeah, we're literally in a ye olde diving suit. In fact, it turns out that walking across the ocean floor is a pretty convenient way to get around Rapture. man. Hacking? I remember that pipe minigame was kind of fun at the start of Bioshock 1, but it wound up getting really old about halfway through it. Oh. Well, it's just a little timing game. Okay. A lot simpler and a little less engaging, but much better in the long term, that's for sure. And it's not a bad bit of design either. If you landed in the green, the larger spots on the meter, you just progress right on through. But if you landed in the blue sections, which are a bit smaller, you actually get some free bonuses. Nice! Way to improve on a bad part of the first game.
And here we are reintroduced to our antagonist, Lamb. I'm not really bothering with the first name because the game doesn't either. Seriously, I think they only say it once. In fact, she really is more of a name than an actual antagonist. We hear from her now and then, but she doesn't really do anything. I guess the writers figure that making us shoot ourselves is motivation enough, and, well, they're not exactly wrong. I mean, I kind of don't really want her to be alive anymore. But remember, we're Big Daddy. Our motivation isn't really to get into an ideological battle with the person who took power of Rapture after Andrew Ryan's death in the first game. Our motivation is to find the little sister that she took from us 10 years ago. And speaking of which...
Father, it's me, Eleanor. I know you're awake in there. I can feel it. Mother won't be able to toy with you like that ever again. This plasmid is for you. If I'm right, you can use it now. Please, find me.
She may be grown up now, but she still remembers us and considers us her dad and Lamb her mom. Well, get ready for one big parenting slash custody dispute metaphor, I guess. We're pretty clearly the favorite here, though, considering she gives us the occasional plasmid care package. That and the fact that every time Lamb contacts us, it's to blather on about Eleanor's destiny and how she's supposed to save Rapture and whatever.
But Eleanor has a destiny, one you cannot share. There is no place for you in paradise.
Jeez, tone it down a bit, lady. It's no wonder she's giving us all the plasmids.
You are a very old Big Daddy, bonded for life to a single little one. When you are apart for too long, your body begins to shut down like a coma. As long as the girl is in the Rapture, you are trapped here as well. The name of your little one is Eleanor Lamb. Daughter of Sophia.
Yeah, that is not a German accent. Anyway, I guess that means we were in a coma this whole time, and Eleanor was just now able to, uncoma us somehow. Honestly, the game never really gives you a good explanation for why it took us 10 years to revive. It's one of those things that doesn't really hold up the more you think about it, so you just have to kind of let it go and accept it for what it is. But enough about that. Time for the best character in the entire series.
Well, look at you. A bona fide knight in armor, complete with iron horse. The name's Augustus Sinclair Sport, Esquire.
I don't know. Maybe it's that dapper southern gentleman charm that makes me like him so much, or just the fact that he reminds me of Gilbert Dotrieve from King of the Hill. Either way, he's the best. Step aside, everybody. Make way for the king.
As you can see, Chief, the station here is iced over. To reach Eleanor Lamb at Fontaine headquarters, we'll have to clear the way.
So now it's off to the amusement park to find a fire plasmid to melt the iced over railway. But there's one problem. Unlike the shock plasmid we got, this one isn't just laying around. We've got to get it the old-fashioned way, through a plasmid vendor. The only problem is that we need Adam for that. In the previous game, that meant finding a little sister. And that's exactly what we have to do in this one. Yes, the little sister hunt makes a return, but unfortunately, being a Big Daddy doesn't mean that we get along with other Big Daddies. And they aren't about to let us just yoink their little sister, so buckle up for a fight. The first Big Daddy fight of the game, and it's actually kind of pathetic. Big Daddies are not hard in this game at all. I guess it makes sense though, since we're a Big Daddy and we're pretty much made out of paper mache. We've got the little sister free, but there's a problem. She doesn't have any Adam on her. So now we've got to do what we saw all the other Big Daddies in the first game do. Wander around looking for a corpse for her to poke. Fortunately, they gave us a pathway there, but finding the body is only the first issue. Next, we have to defend her from splicers while she gathers the Adam. Like I said before, we're surprisingly weak, and a big gauntlet section doesn't make it any easier. especially when we have to do it a second time after that on a different body. Eventually we finish that up and take her to a vent. Now we have the same choice from the first game, rescue or harvest. Rescuing gives you less Adam, but over time will get you rewards from Little Sisters. Harvesting gives you extra Adam, but kills the Little Sister. Given we're a Big Daddy, I think it'd be weird to harvest them, but I guess really we're only bound to one Little Sister. Either way, I never had Adam issues in the first game, and I remember the rewards being worthwhile, so I'll be rescuing them. No matter what the choice though, Lamb's not big on us interfering with the Little Sisters, and so she sends a Big Sister after us for a much more difficult fight than the Big Daddy. Unfortunately for her though, we've got a giant drill arm that does crazy amounts of damage, so the fight is just a matter of holding mouse 1 while the drill runs and spamming health kits when we get low. Once she's dealt with, we head back to the train station and meet the man himself.
I like to look a man in the eye when I give him my word. You and me, kid, we're going places.
He travels along in the train with us, unfortunately just in a separate compartment, but you know, I guess it's still nice to have another person traveling around Rapture with us. Or at least riding with us to the next station, where Lamb can lock the place down. So now that we're out of the first level, I have to say that I'm not actually sure whether or not I like the game yet or not. It's kind of strange because usually by this point I've got at least a good or bad first impression, but this time kind of nothing. The shooting's okay, level design's alright, and the gameplay seems fine enough, but there's nothing that I especially hate, and there's nothing that stands out as exceptionally good either.
On to find the governor for the lockdown key then.
And now you come swanning into my neighborhood, looking for me. Wrong turn, Tin Daddy. When we hang you from a streetlight and you choking out your last, I want you to remember my face.
Well, that's one way to fast-track yourself to the top of the old shit list.
There's also more Little Sisters in this area. You can harvest them right off the bat if you really want to, and I imagine you could just skip them altogether if you wanted. You'd miss out on health and Eve upgrades though, but that might not necessarily be a problem. Because this is Bioshock after all, you can just respawn after you die.
And these harvesting segments are the worst part of the entire game. They take forever, and as far as I know, they're the only time where dying actually matters. If you die during one of these gauntlets, you have to start it all over again. I remember people talking about this game and saying how these segments turned it into one giant escort mission, which, to be fair, that's not exactly true. The Little Sisters ordinarily just stay on your shoulder, they don't take damage, and if you wind up dying, they just wind up outside of the Vita Chamber right in front of you. But when you have two or sometimes three Little Sisters per level, and each one has two gauntlets that you have to do for them, it gets exhausting.
Soon we find a nice little return from Bioshock 1 with a camera, but with a small tweak. Rather than taking pictures of enemies, we're videotaping them. We only have a certain amount of time to damage them to get research, and we have to kill them in different ways to maximize our point gain over time. As we hit certain milestones, we get increased damage against that enemy type, but we can also get bigger upgrades like speed increases, Eve upgrades, and special plasmids. It's a pretty nice bonus to have since our damage is falling behind some, and since we're a Big Daddy, I'd like to actually feel powerful. Speaking of special upgrades from the camera, there's a pile of rubble blocking our way from the governor, so we have to hit a research milestone of this fat boy to learn the drill dash ability. And now to never use this ability ever again because it's total dog shit. Seriously, you dash forward like 5 feet, barely deal any damage, and it puts a delay on your drill which just leaves you standing defenseless right next to an enemy.
Grace's room is just up ahead. Now, she's been sending all manner of unkindness your way, so I'm not particular as to how you take that key away from her, but she's old, and this grudge against you was based on a misunderstanding.
I missed the part where that's my problem.
Swan song. Well, I back your survival instinct, Chief. In Rapture, a bleeding heart tends to bring in the sharks.
But I forgave Grace for that. And you murdered her. Ratifying her bigotry.
I mean, ratified bigotry or not, she's still dead, so, I guess I win. A second little sister, big sister, and big daddy later, we're overloaded with atoms, so I stock up on a ton of upgrades before we head out to the train station to lift the lockdown.
Hear me, O ye who would murder the Lamb of God! Ye shall never reach her god!
You son of a bitch, I swear to God if you killed Sinclair.
Kid,
okay.
Come on, wake up.
That's
now.
Fine then.
There you are. I thought you rode that torpedo into the great hereafter.
I see Father Wales has parted you from your craft, and yet you cling to life.
Yeah, Lamb. Even if we had died, you do know that the Vita Chambers are a thing, right? You do know that, don't you? Or have you just been sitting in your office this whole time wondering how we grew a new head?
The train tunnels are flooding, so we've got to get to the pumping station to pump all the water out. Because remember, Sinclair is stuck in the train and his air's running out. Fortunately, he has got a lot of air because I think this is the longest level in the entire game. The guy who shot us is pretty much inconsequential and is just a throwaway, to be honest. But the level itself is memorable for being hard as hell. Almost every enemy has a gun now, and the ones that don't are spider splicers who are tanky as hell and rush us down. Not to mention, this is the first level that has three little sisters, which means we have three big daddies to kill and six of those atom gauntlets to run. And speaking of big daddies, I have to say this is disappointing. Sure, I get that big daddies can't exactly kill splicers, otherwise half the level would be dead, but they could at least make them run away rather than just smack them for zero damage, and then have the splicer run right back up in their face. Unfortunately, this game doesn't really do Big Daddy's justice. In fact, it kinda neuters them. Which is sad because they really could've used this opportunity to make Big Daddy's even more badass. But instead, they just trivialize them to make the Big Sisters seem even better. Which is not really the route I would've gone with considering this is the mascot of the series we're talking about. The priest guy, who I think has only spoken to us once since we've been here, ends up just being a tanky spider splicer, so it's a forgettable end to a forgettable character. Fortunately, we reached the pumping station in time to rescue Sinclair, but it turns out Lamb thought this might happen and had a plan, which was to flood the area with water.
Seriously? What the hell is that? We have literally walked across the ocean floor. Everybody knows we can do that. How is this her plan?
Well, anyway, we're meeting up with Sinclair in Dionysus Park's train station, where they try really hard to repeat the same scare that they did with the Houdini splicers in the first game. That's a little, but whatever. Lamb locks down the station, for a change, but this area's third party is actually on our side. Stan Poole has the means to end the lockdown, but he needs us to help him out first. Adam can apparently store the memories of the person it's harvested from, and Lamb knows how to read those memories. Apparently, something happened in the park that would make Lamb want to kill Stan, so he wants us to prevent those memories from being harvested. Which means dealing with all the little sisters in the level. Sounds sketchy? Well, that's because it is. Every time we rescue one of the little sisters, Eleanor is able to tell us a new memory about Stan. And as it turns out, he was left in charge of the park while Lamb was away, ended up blowing all their money on parties and other whatnottery. Then, when Eleanor found out, she threatened to tell Lamb, which ended up with Stan selling her to an orphanage that later turned her into a little sister. And if that didn't already max out his renegade meter, then how about flooding the area and killing everybody when Lamb came back so she wouldn't find out about any of it?
I'm not really sure how he got away with that one, but we've seen Lamb isn't exactly dealing with a full deck, so I shouldn't be too surprised.
Now we get probably the best upgrade in the entire game, which is a passive upgrade that increases the Little Sister's gathering speed. This takes a pretty good chunk off the Atom Gauntlet segments, and is just such a nice quality of life upgrade. After the final Little Sister is rescued, we get a message from Lamb telling us that Stan was the one who found us as a stranded diver years ago in Rapture, and turned us over to Andrew Ryan, who then turned us into a big daddy. Why is she telling us this? So we can kill him when she opens the door to his room, of course. Well, I'm not playing your game, Lamb. I only kill the people you like.
I'm not exactly the biggest Stanley fan myself, but if Lamb wants him dead, then that's enough motivation for me to let him live. Besides which, he never actually betrayed us during all of this, and he did what he said he was going to do, so what do I care? I'd much rather let him live just to spite Lamb.
So far, my biggest complaint in this game has been that we feel really weak for being a big daddy, but our journey to Fontaine HQ is just about to fix that with one upgrade. The damage research gene. It doesn't make us into a walking tank, we still take a ton of damage, but it does increase how much damage our research bonuses give us, which makes us do a ton of damage. In Bioshock 1, it increased them by 30%, with a later increase to 60% in one of the DLCs. Bioshock 2 feels like it has to be around 50%. It's a massive improvement. This area's interloper, Gil Alexander. He tells us in this pre-recorded message that in modern day he's going to be insane and that we should kill him when we find him.
Gil Alexander. As I recall, he was involved in Big Daddy development from the beginning. Likely had something to do with you and Eleanor, son.
Also that. The reason we need to find him, though, is because the entrance to Lamb's hideout is genetically locked, and we need a sample from Gil in order to get through. We're given an introduction to modern-day Gil through a flying TV screen that's quite a bit different from the recording we watched earlier. For instance, he's a bit of a dick. Say hello to the new big bad on the block, the Big Daddy Alpha. And he's a huge joke, of course.
At this point, the game's actually kind of easy. I get nuked, sure, but I've been playing the game long enough that I know how to deal with that. Plus, the extra damage bonus has been helping out a lot with that, too. The blue bar from the hacking minigame gives us a ton of free supplies, and my wallet's been maxed since the second level. Bioshock 2's difficulty is what's called an inverted difficulty curve.
Ordinarily, a game starts easy and gradually gets harder as it goes on, but Bioshock 2 is the opposite. We start off with few resources and take a ton of damage for as little health as we have. But as we go on, we get more weapons, weapon upgrades, research damage, health from Adam, better plasmids, more specialized ammo types, gene upgrades, and it all starts building up to where we're finally able to reach a level where I'd say we're about Bioshock 1 Big Daddy strength.
It's only made easier by the fact that Vita Chambers make it impossible for you to die, but it is worth noting that Bioshock 2 does include an option to disable the Vita Chamber respawns.
Sophia and I knew that to create the first true utopian would come at a high cost, my friend. We needed someone to be host to all that Adam, Rapture's finest minds. A willing subject, that is to say, myself. Whatever you may have seen inside the tank, that was indeed me. I fear the fate of Eleanor Lamb will be less physical, but no less grotesque.
So, in other words, Lamb wants to make Eleanor, her daughter, like Gil. Just a consciousness stuck in a giant jar of Adam. You know, I think I might know why Eleanor likes us so much better.
Before we kill him, though, we rescue the last little sister of the game. The previous little sister reward we got increased their harvesting speed and was one of the best genes in the entire game. So I can only imagine what we get for the last upgrade. $100, some Adam, and a Twinkie.
My disappointment is immeasurable. And my day is ruined.
Poor things. What a life. Marching around, playing daddy, until some splicer manages to kill off their sister. And then if the coma doesn't take them, they turn maniac.
That's the second time they've mentioned Big Daddy's going into a coma when separated from their little sister. Looks like we've got a choice to kill Gil or just walk away. His pre-recorded message seems like the way to go, and in an earlier message, Lamb tries to guilt trip us into not killing him, so that just makes our choice even easier. With a genetic key all ready, we head into Lamb's hideout and find Eleanor.
Eleanor, forgive me.
Okay, now I definitely know why she likes us more.
But it's okay. Lam only killed Eleanor just enough to break our bond with her and still be able to revive her afterwards. If that doesn't make much sense, then this is where it gets a little convoluted. Apparently, the bond with Eleanor is broken to the point where our character will eventually die, despite what we'd heard several times throughout the game about either going into a coma or going crazy, but it's not broken enough to where she can't talk to us in our heads still.
It's me, Eleanor. I'm so sorry.
Seem a little strange? Well, according to the almighty internet, there were a lot of things, major things, with this story that got changed last minute. Like, for instance, Eleanor was originally supposed to be the only big sister, and she was supposed to fight you every single level. So I guess it's not surprising that smaller things like this get a little bit muddled here and there. And that might also explain a few gaps and fuzzy motivations in the story as well. We aren't able to escape on our own, and so Eleanor sends us a special plasmid via Little Sister. This leads us to an interesting section where we get to take control of a little sister and see Rapture as they do. It's an interesting segment that's kind of fun and ends with us assembling a full suit of Big Sister armor for Eleanor. She comes to break us out, and now we have one last goal. Get an escape pod ready so that Eleanor, Sinclair, and I can escape. And speaking of Sinclair, where is he?
Don't you recognize Sinclair, Delta?
Oh no! Lam got him and turned him into a big daddy, son of a bitch! He's got the key that we need for the escape pod and can't control himself. But he's a gentleman to the end and helps us find a way to get into the room he's locked in to kill him and take the key. Great. I'm glad we get a choice for literally every minor character in the entire game except for Sinclair, and he's the only one I actually care about. Of course, Lam was busy while we were getting the key, and she sabotaged the launching system for the escape pod. But there's a backup plan. Eleanor is going to gather the little sisters, and together, they are going to use their atom to superheat the water beneath the pod, to boil it, and launch the pod out of the ocean. Oh, and you know Lam's really earning that Mother of the Year award by going the extra mile to kill her daughter by blowing up Rapture to drop it into a trench and drown everyone. One last gauntlet later, we escape to see the ending that our choices made.
And then, Father, the Rapture dream was over. You taught me that evil is just a word. Under the skin, it's simple pain. For you, mercy was victory. You sacrificed, you endured, and when given the chance, you forgave. Always. Mother believed this world was irredeemable, but she was wrong, Father.
What? Bullshit! I didn't teach you that! I forgave people to spite your mom, who, by the way, planned to turn you into a living jar of fucking Kool-Aid, killed you, and literally just now tried to blow you up for wanting to leave home. There's forgiveness, and then they're saving a goddamn psychopath who's probably still managed to rack up a higher body count than me. Oh, and we die.
You will always be with me now, Father. Your memories, your drives. And when I need you, you'll be there on my shoulder, whispering.
Good ending, my ass. Fuck it. Name me, I'll be shooting craps with Sinclair in the billiard room of that big plantation in the sky. And we're not talking about the one in Bioshock Infinite, either.
In the end, Bioshock 2 felt more like an expansion than it did a second game. Granted, it didn't feel like a bad expansion, but it was far from what I would expect a sequel to be. The simple plot was stretched a bit thin, the gameplay was only slightly improved, and the levels felt a bit more formulaic than the originals, although they weren't really bad, and overall, it was pretty easy to forget. And in the end, I think that's probably why people don't really talk about it when talking about the series. They don't not like it, they just forget it even exists.
That's not to say it was bad, though. It started off a little slow, but definitely got better as it went on. Although it did take a while for me to definitively say I was enjoying it.
as far as where I would put it overall, I can't exactly say that I thought that it was great. It wasn't bad. I guess it's somewhere maybe between good and okay. But that's the problem, isn't it? This wasn't just any game. This was a follow-up to BioShock. They needed to hit it out of the park to be considered a success. They definitely didn't strike out, but it was no grand slam.
Maybe the problem was that the original was never going to be surpassed by a sequel. There's that saying that lightning never strikes the same spot twice, and I think that's very true in Rapture's case. The original setting was so unique when it first came out. Nobody had ever seen anything like it before. To set this sequel in the same location was dooming it to fail to begin with. And the original dev team knew that. It was one of the reasons they decided to go the complete opposite direction with BioShock Infinite's setting. They knew Rapture would never have the impact that it did with the first game, and so they just left it alone.
But as far as failed sequels go, that could have been much worse. I still had fun with it after all. Personally, I'm just glad it didn't wind up being another Blood 2. But that's about all I can say about BioShock 2 for now, so everyone, thank you very much for watching, and I'll see you in the next review.